If you're looking for a place to go and find some trophies, this is the place to be in the charge of trophies. If you're on Xbox and need some gamer score, come over here, I'll help you get some more. My name is Kenzie Retro, the host of the show, gaming news and reviews and all you need to know. Because the weekend is finally here at last, sit back, relax, enjoy the Trophy Achievement Podcast.
FIFA 18 World Cup mode release date news and features. All you need to know about the free tournament mode. Right, let's see. Again, increase the zoom size. There we go. Boom. FIFA 19 might be hovering on the horizon, but that doesn't mean FIFA 18 is ready to be traded in. In fact, along with a constant flow of FUT updates, EA Canada is planning something special to celebrate the 2018 FIFA World Cup in Russia. Rather than opting to release a standalone edition, the studio will follow the trend of recent years with free World Cup related content. So to get you in the mood for the biggest sporting event of the year, biggest sporting event of the year, minus the Commonwealth Games, because as far as I'm concerned, the true biggest sporting event in the world is the Olympic Games.
Yeah.
But anyway, we've gathered together every detail and nugget of info you could possibly need. Right. Take note, FIFA fans. This is what we need to know. Let's cut to the chase. What is it? A free and officially licensed tournament mode for FIFA 18. Okay. When can I play it? May 29th, which is...
not far.
4 weeks away. 4 weeks from yesterday, in fact. Yeah. What can I play it on? The mode will appear on PS4, Xbox One, PC, and Nintendo Switch. Release date. The real life World Cup 2018 runs from June 14th to July 15th, but you'll be able to download and play the official tournament mode 2 weeks prior on all platforms listed above. The release date was officially announced on April 30th, with EA confirming that the mode will be arriving on all platforms. Yes, that includes Nintendo Switch, in brackets, on the same day. Unfortunately, the mode won't be coming to any old-gen platforms, so sorry, PS3 and Xbox 360 owners. I think we're 5-6 years now into the current console gaming generation. This is the point now where you actually need to consider, do I need my PS3 and Xbox 360 anymore? And if not, trade it in and get yourself an Xbox. Whether you get the base Xbox One or the Xbox One S or the new one that just came out last year, the Xbox One X, which has been dubbed as the most powerful console in the world with 4K resolution.
Oh, wow.
So I think definitely right now with the 4K updates, it's extended the lifespan of this current gaming generation. I would definitely say it's going to take us to at least mid-2020 before we actually get new consoles out, like the PlayStation 5.
That's true. When did the Xbox 360 come out, do you know?
2005.
Wow. I think I got it then.
13 years ago.
Wow.
Yeah. Let's see. But it may finally be... Right. Here we go. So, sorry. There we go. So, unfortunately, the mode won't be coming to any old-gen platforms. Sorry, PS3 and Xbox 360. But it may finally be time to give up the ghost and upgrade. Literally what I just mentioned. However, owners of the FIFA mobile app will be getting in on the action, with a special World Cup-themed update arriving on June 6th, although this will be for a limited time. So get playing on the go while you have the chance. Key features. Let's see what we have. The console version of the World Cup mode will feature all 32 teams that have qualified for the tournament, including likeness and names for all the players, although a good chunk of these are already present in FIFA 18. Even the official kits of each national side will be present and correct in virtual form. You'll also get access to the 12 Russian stadia, see below for full list of the stadia, plural, so stadium. Stadiums, stadiums. But anyway, they'll be used during the real-life tournament, recreated with the same attention to detail and match-day presentation you've come to expect from the rest of the base game. Even pitch conditions relative to each stadium will be on point. The official match ball will also be included. Naturally, can't have any of this. Naturally, can't have any of this generic nonsense. That's actually what they put in brackets here. Naturally, can't have any of this generic nonsense. They actually put that in brackets! As will the proper FIFA World Cup trophy for added authenticity when your team goes on to win the final. Now, unsurprisingly, depending on where you are in the world, you're going to choose your home nation.
Yeah.
Just for, you know, patriotism. So, the stadia, right. So anyway, here we go. The real-life stadia sets for the free update are the St. Petersburg Stadium in, well, St. Petersburg, the Fisht Stadium in Sochi, Ekaterinburg Stadium in Ekaterinburg, Kazan Arena in Kazan, Nizhny Novgorod Stadium in Nizhny Novgorod, Rostov Arena in Rostov-on-Don, Samara Arena in, well, Samara, the Mordovia Arena in Saransk, the Volgograd Arena in Volgograd, Spartak Stadium in Moscow, Kaliningrad Stadium in Kaliningrad, and Deluzhniki Stadium in Moscow.
Couple there in Moscow.
Mm. Yeah, two Moscow stadiums, one in St. Petersburg. And a lot of them are just basically in the cities that they're in. Which reminds me. Capital of Russia. Moscow. I would imagine they'll have the... Actually, just double check. FIFA World Cup 2018. Which stadium is it going to be in? It's going to be in the Luzhniki Stadium in Moscow. I mean, they normally have the final of the World Cup in the capital of the country. Okay, so we got the World Cup Mode Gallery. Okay.
It's quite nice.
Yeah, they weren't kidding about the attention to detail.
Even the tattoos.
Yeah. The update will also include some custom cinematics to help recreate the atmosphere of the real event, although EA has yet to confirm whether this will include any new animations or fresh commentary. We'd go as far to say it'll at least have all the official graphics from any upcoming TV broadcasts. I mean, unsurprisingly, everybody's going to be paying attention to the World Cup this summer. So what about all those teams that didn't make it into the Final 32? Well, weep not, USA and Chile fans, because plenty of those teams will also be included in the free content update. Okay. Although, you'll only be able to play them in custom tournaments and friendlies. It's a nice touch, and one that will keep players in countries who didn't qualify involved during the heat of the tournament itself. Can't argue with that. Most of the game modes, with the exception of The Journey, Punter Returns, are getting some form of update with new content. These include 2018 FIFA World Cup Russia mode, a tournament setup that will see you duking it out from the group stage to the final. custom FIFA World Cup tournament, that aforementioned setup of for unqualified nations, FIFA World Cup kickoff, supporting local offline local player with friends, local multiplayer with friends using those official teams, kits, and stadia. And FIFA World Cup Ultimate Team, including all the bells and whistles. Bells and whistles, whatever that means. This being FIFA, there's also plenty of new themed content coming to the long-term cell that is FIFA Ultimate Team. The World Cup mode patch will include an impressive raft of updates, including a new chemistry system that will use a player's nationality and confederation rather than their league or club to determine how they operate in FUT. Now, I mean, obviously the nationality is kind of a given, but for the confederation, it would be something like UEFA, which is Europe. So say you've got Jamie Vardy and Cristiano Ronaldo. They're both part of the same confederation based on the country they are representing.
Right.
But they wouldn't have as much chemistry because Cristiano Ronaldo's Portugal and Jamie Vardy's England.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you had someone like Danny Welbeck, that is perfect chemistry because they're both England and they're both part of the same confederation.
Right, okay.
I was like, always handy to explain things, always handy to have simple explanations for newcomers. where was I? Yeah, EA Canada says this will add a fresh yet familiar dimension to how you build and organise your squad. All the qualified players will be present with up-to-date stats, so you can be sure any pack you open will be representative of each player that's going into this summer's tournament. And they've got a reveal trailer here featuring Cristiano Ronaldo himself. I mean, reason why I mentioned Cristiano Ronaldo, because he's right now. All right, here we go.
Can Cristiano Ronaldo send Portugal into the World Cup semi-final? He can!
I like the music in the background. Okay, I mean, it kind of needs to be upbeat to get people like to play there.
Welcome to the World Cup in Russia.
Nice.
For the players.
That is definitely a very good trailer. The only small drawback is that they didn't include the iconic EA Sports. It's in the game at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, not very often you hear me guys praising something regarding Electronic Arts. but maybe sometimes I can be a bit too harsh on these companies sometimes. Sometimes I can be a bit too harsh on EA and Activision.
There's nothing wrong with critical thinking.
Yeah, let's say there's being critical and then there's tearing them apart. Now, anyway, Destiny 2 Warmind DLC Crucible maps have been revealed. I do like the armor these guys are wearing.
I like it.
Yeah. Warmind, hang on. As always, increase the zoom. Boom! That's better, we can actually read it now. Right. Warmind, Destiny 2's next expansion, is just days away from launching and adding new content on both the PvE and PvP side of the game, including two Crucible maps that Bungie has just officially revealed. The two maps are titled Meltdown and Solitude, and both look like they take place on Mars, the destination of focus in Destiny 2's Warmind DLC. There is not a lot of information to go on, but based on the screenshots and what has been revealed about Warmind so far, it appears that Meltdown takes place in a Clovis Bray facility in the Braytech Futurescape, where Solitude takes place, while Solitude takes place on the polar ice caps of Hellas Basin.
Hmm.
And there's the screenshots here. So that's...
it's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, the... right, so that one's Meltdown. And there's the ice caps. Okay. Meltdown features familiar Mars architecture with its futuristic buildings and red sand. In PvE, this is the location where players will go to meet the DLC's new vendor, Anna Bray. On the other side, Solitude will present a frozen landscape for players to battle each other. These two maps will be available for all players within Crucible Matchmaking, whether they own the Warmind expansion or not. This is a switch for Destiny, whereas in the past, any new Crucible maps were only available to those who bought the DLC. However, what will remain exclusive to those who buy Warmind will be the ability to play Solitude and Meltdown in private matches. So you're getting the maps anyway, but the only perk that those that actually buy the DLC mm-hmm. is they're able to use the maps in private matches.
Oh. Okay.
That's pretty much it. That doesn't really make much sense. Because if you're going to be able to use them in public matches anyway, sure, you should be able to use them in private matches without having to buy them separately.
Mm.
Those maps aren't the only elements that are new for PvP in Warmind. Warmind and its accompanying game update will add Crucible ranks, a feature that players have asked for since before the game even launched last year. The meta of the game should also get a shake-up with the arrival of newly buffed exotics, which look to take many of the game's top-tier weapons to an entirely new level. Destiny 2 Warmind releases on May 8th for PC, PS4, and Xbox One. Okay. You know, like I say, the only sticking point with that is the fact that everybody's going to get the maps anyway, and yet those that actually purchase the DLC, even though it's going to be part of the update regardless, are able to use the maps in private matches.
Seems like a waste of time.
Exactly!
Okay then, love that logic.
Now,
yay.
For your favourite article of this, I say that's a screenshot from Earthbound, a game on the Super Nintendo. Right, here we go. This is going to be interesting. This will be a good read. Let's see. In the back of our heads, we were like, I hope that people don't laugh us out of the room for wanting to do a soundtrack to a video game on vinyl. Mo Shafiq, Rook record label manager for Mondo Death Waltz Recording Company, says, and no one did. When we announced it, people were super positive about it, and it did really well. How about that? They weren't alone. Classic and modern video games alike are seeing their soundtracks released on the once thought to be dead medium. I mean, these days, vinyls are definitely back in the mainstream now.
Yeah, I've got a few.
Yeah. Everything from the Nintendo 64 masterpiece Banjo-Kazooie to the recent indie phenomenon Shovel Knight, the old classic NES title Castlevania, Nintendo's obscure and quirky Mother 2, known as Earthbound over here in Europe, and US, anyway, and Bethesda's open-world RPG, The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim, have all gotten or are getting vinyl releases. What once was a rarity is now a washed... is now awash in the sea of releases for both gaming's yesteryear and modernity. And modernity. How do you pronounce that? Los Angeles-based I Am 8-Bit, for instance, released its first video game soundtrack on vinyl in 2010. In 2015, it released 7.
Nice.
In 2016, that number grew to 24, with some releases hitting the Billboard vinyl charts. That is cool!
That is brilliant!
I love that.
The Hero of Time, music based on The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time, many people regard that as one of the greatest video games of all time, originally came out on the Nintendo 64, and the Persona 5 vinyl, both charted. The company's vinyl soundtrack for Journey is still a daily bestseller. While vinyl releases weren't always commonplace, consumers and gaming companies are getting through a similar process. Are going through a similar process. Mondo, for instance, tried to follow the release of Naughty Dog's blockbuster The Last of Us, which we mentioned at the start of the podcast, by contacting other companies, but found that not a lot of people were into the idea. Konami was the only company that was really like, oh yeah, that would be really cool. You should do that, Shafiq says. Since then, the sentiment has shifted, and Mondo has released 9 total video game soundtracks on vinyl, getting the actual audio for the games. Getting the actual audio for the games, however, isn't always cut and dry. Sometimes Mondo gets masters from composers or the studio that they'll take and remaster for vinyl. The analog format requires a little bit of EQing before you go into the process, just to make sure that it sounds as optimal as it can be. Shafiq says, but for some of the older titles, that wasn't the case, and they actually had to generate the audio from the original game. Yeah, I can see how difficult that would be for some of the older games, like they mentioned the Castlevania, the 8-bit, 16-bit era, Sonic the Hedgehog, Super Mario, all that jazz.
I do love the idea, though.
Yeah. To some degree, vinyl soundtracks are as old as video games themselves. Back in the 1970s, Kraftwerk toyed with early game bleeps and beats, while the Yellow Magic Orchestra's 1978 self-titled album sampled tunes from Circus, Space Invaders, and Gunfight. Okay. Given that when the legendary Nintendo composer Koji Kondo wrote the Super Mario Bros. Soundtrack in 1985, the NES could only play 3 notes simultaneously. It's taken an increasing sophistication in composers' options to lift game scores from novelty to collector's item. Although the Triforce Quartet performing Super Mario Bros. Theme with a full string section for 2014's Game Covers album, The Legend of Ellipsis proves that a good tune is a good tune, however it's first recorded. Mondo's soundtracks now range from retro titles like Castlevania, Castlevania 3, Contra, and Contra, to more recent games like Valve's Portal. For the modern releases, things are a mix between Mondo reaching out to studios, or studios reaching out to Mondo. And ideally, Shafiq has 6 months to work on any given vinyl project. The manufacturing process is such a wild card and a roll of the dice that, like, even if you thread every needle there, you're still looking at sometimes it's 5 weeks, sometimes it's 12, he explains. Shafiq thinks that there is still a stigma associated with the reissue vinyl world, but he adds, in 5 years, it's not going to be bizarre to see in a record store the soundtrack to the next Call of Duty game, the next soundtrack to the next Naughty Dog game, to the next Uncharted game. It will be the video game soundtrack section of the record store. That I can get behind at HMV.
Yes.
Which reminds me, the Mass Effect games, especially the first 3, fantastic soundtrack all round. Mm-hmm. Just throughout the entire trilogy. So what I'm gonna do now is, let's see. Right, there we go. That is the Suicide Mission score that was part of Mass Effect 2. And that is regarded as one of the greatest games ever made. Primarily because, as I say, and the Suicide Mission in particular, one of the greatest final stages in video game history because of the high stakes, the music, and just the epic feel just from the music in the background alone, for me, anyway.
It's nostalgic.
Not just...
I think for a lot of people, and...
I say not just nostalgic, I mean, it's nostalgic when you look back on
it.
When you go through it for the first time. But when you went through it for the first time, you were just like, this is gonna be amazing. And safe to say, it didn't disappoint. It did not disappoint. That like actually sells them a movement. IM 8-bit, meanwhile, is putting out records everywhere for last year's throwback hit platformer, Cuphead. So there's a vinyl out there for Cuphead. Let's see. That video's there for Triforce Quartet for Super Mario Medley. For us, vinyl is very much about storytelling, and it's a very expensive thing to make, and it's a very expensive thing for consumers to obtain. It's a pricey endeavor, and it's not the same as downloading something on iTunes. And if they're not wrong now, having the vinyl it's going to have value 10, 15, 20 years later down the line. Exactly. So we take a lot of care in selecting soundtracks that are going to provide for a really cool experience. And like I said, the Mass Effect games, the soundtracks for the Mass Effect games would be so cool on vinyl. John Gibson said, come on over, I mean. There's a lot of people out there who just don't realise the quality of the music that is available via games. Exactly. I've mentioned this before, that video game soundtracks
are overlooked.
And film scores as well are overlooked as well, because having music like this can have such a huge impact on how immersed you are in the game. And film, in the case of film scores. There's a lot of people that are Amanda White, it's an acknowledgement of the quality and the value of the musical experience to gameplay itself. For 2018, the company has released his plan, including hit franchises like Uncharted, Mario, and Pokemon, coming to the once thought to be dead format. Sometimes the score just gets forgotten, like you said, overlooked. And so it's taken a beat for even the people making games to realise the value of that element. Of course, they know it matters because they planned for it to be there in the first place. But really understanding that it can stand on its own and that it deserves to be held up as something to honour, that takes a minute to think, I think, for people to come around to ideas like that. When it is such a collaboration of such a collage of things that come together to create a creative product of the game. Mondo and 8-Bit aren't the only companies releasing video game soundtracks either. New York City-based Shape to Shore Phonoco has released titles including Mother 2, Earthbound for Players in the West, Rocket Knight Adventures, and Axiom Verge. And deciding which video game soundtracks the company brings to vinyl has gotten, well, personal. For the most part so far, it's really been just a matter of personal taste, Aaron Hamill, co-founder of Ship to Shore Phonoco, said. You know, Snatcher and Mother 2 are two of my favourite games of all time. In terms of sales, Ship to Shore's video game releases sell better as direct sales, while the company's film and reissue vinyls do better through retail or wholesale. For Mother 2, the company's biggest game vinyl release. They've pressed around 600,000 copies to date.
Oh, wow.
And in terms of the people buying these records, Hamill thinks there's a huge video game vinyl community developing.
I'll happily get on board with that.
It's really quite nice because when I started doing it, I really didn't know if it would take off. I didn't know if anybody would want to buy game music on vinyl, except for like me and some nerdy friends of mine. But it turns out a lot of people do. It's a great time to be a game music fan and a record collector at the same time, he added. And if Aphex Twin is reading this, the original bleep score for Pong remains unrecorded.
Wow.
Oh my word. It would just be boop, 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 burp. That's all it would be.
Have that on a loop.
Yeah. Alright. God of War. Games no longer where actors' careers go up to die. Right, let's increase the zoom and on we go. Actor Christopher Judge says gaming used to be where you went when your career was over in front of camera. Now the man who plays the lead character Kratos in the newly released God of War claims that perception is changing. Reading the script for the first time, I thought it was for a big A-list film, he tells BBC Newsbeat.
Oh.
Now every actor I know is searching for a lead role in a game, the Stargate SG-1 star added. Oh, he was in Stargate. Okay.
Yeah.
The latest in the God of War franchise has marketed itself as a tale of a parent struggling to develop a relationship with his son. I can get behind stories like that. It takes Kratos, one of the most iconic gaming characters of recent years, and gives him an emotional depth and complexity that the series has never seen before. Christopher says he had no clue he was reading a script for a video game when it was emailed to him. I'm sure my agents purposefully didn't tell me it was for a game because I'd been staunchly against doing them in the past, he says. And given the fact that what you mentioned, mm-hmm. It's easy to see why. I had to act out the audition. Wait, hang on. I missed a couple of things there. Performing in video games has been a very specialist art form until recent years. A domain for actors who performed mostly in games that and did not appear on television screens all that often. Christopher says he was some way through the process of auditioning before realizing the true nature of the project. I had to act out the audition. That's something you don't have to do for theatrical auditions. So that was my first clue. The material was so good though I didn't care. And after a further callback, I was told it was for a game. But I was fine with it because it didn't seem to be written like that. I mean, you're definitely finding that a lot with games these days. You're finding that the writing and voice acting, you'd think you were actually through the cutscenes especially, you'd think you were watching a film.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I mean, God of War, they've just mentioned. I mean, Uncharted 4, which came out in 2016, so cinematic. The music, the writing, it was for many people their game of the year.
Uh-huh.
And it's easy to see why. Horizon Zero Dawn last year as well. That was really well put together. Again, for the same reasons. And now we've got God of War this year. 10 out of 10s across the board. Then I was even called to do a chemistry test with 10-year-old Solijek, who plays the son of Kratos in the game. And I called my agent and said, Are you sure this is for a game? Big game actors have provided voices for gamers for games for years, mainly though in supporting roles. Ah, here we go. Now this is where things get interesting. Samuel L. Jackson in Grand Theft Auto San Andreas.
I love you.
Natalie Dormer. I'm trying to think what I've
Game
heard.
Of Thrones?
Possibly. Let's double check. Yeah, you were right, Game of Thrones. Hunger Games as well. And Captain America.
Okay, I didn't know those last two, but I've heard of her because, yeah, Game of Thrones.
Yeah. So here we go. And Michael Fassbender in Fable 3. Let's see, if Michael Fassbender was in the Assassin's Creed film.
Yeah.
Also, what else was he? He was in the X-Men films as well as Magneto. Kit Harington. Ah, another Game of Thrones actor. However, in recent years, more and more familiar faces from the silver screen have provided full motion capture performances or voiced lead characters as well. Kit Harington starred in Call of Duty Infinite Warfare. I say Kit Harington is Jon Snow.
Mm-hmm.
Ellen Page was in Beyond Two Souls. What else has she been in? Wait, hang on. Right. Ah, Juno, Inception.
Hard Candy's an intense movie.
She's been in a couple of X-Men films as well. A lot of these I've not really heard of.
I think she does more activism now.
Yeah. I say she's done a couple of video game roles as well. So one of them being Beyond Two Souls. Kiefer Sutherland from 24, when he played Jack Bauer. He voiced Big Boss in Metal Gear Solid 5. Christopher, famous for his roles in Stargate SG-1 and Batman The Dark Knight Rises, tells us that the perception of acting in games has been changing for some time. It used to be where you went when your career was over in front of camera. However, the notion that games are where old actors go to die was slowly starting to dissipate because Kevin Spacey has just done a lead in a game as well. He tells us, now every actor I know is searching for a lead role in a game. So that's how far the industry has come. Games are not just about gameplay anymore, but about the stories. Couldn't agree more. There are wonderful tales to be told in this medium, and it truly is just another form to exercise your craft. Like I said, couldn't agree more. Couldn't agree more. Two of the biggest video game actors, Nolan North and Troy Baker. Troy Baker is Joel in The Last of Us. But he was also Sam, who's Nathan Drake's brother, in Uncharted 4. Nathan Drake, portrayed by Nolan North, he was also in the Assassin's Creed games, and he's done a couple of other projects on top of that. So, here we go. Pac-Man Stories game announced for Amazon Alexa. I mean, even this article's questioning. Even the article title's questioning.
Yeah.
What's going on? Right. Here we go. Okay. Bandai Namco has revealed a new Pac-Man title, but is the voice-activated kids game a sign of things to come for gaming? Virtual assistants like Siri and Amazon Alexa are one of those technologies where we've already seen the idea perfected in sci-fi films, and it just feels like we're slowly waiting until real life catches up with it. Devices like Amazon Echo still feel excitingly cutting edge, but up till now, it's never seemed like anything that would have much relevance for video games. There is actually already a ghost-themed Destiny companion app and some fighting fantasy game book adaptations, But Pac-Man Stories is one of the first games to be created by a traditional publisher. Pac-Man Stories is purely aimed at kids and works on any Alexa device, so not just Echo. It's a similar idea to Fighting Fantasy and other choose-your-own-adventure concepts. Oh, it's one of those games! In that you listen along to the story and then make moral decisions that affect the ending. Oh my word, that is so cool!
I love that.
The first story is called Pac-Man and the Ghastly Garbage, which apparently involves saving Pac-Man's planet from a refuse problem and winning power pellets based on the decisions you make. I'm getting Alexa to try this out because that is so cool! More stories are due to be available throughout the summer and presumably beyond if the idea catches on. It's got our attention, that's for certain! Oh, we have definitely got to try this out on my channel at some point. We have got to try it out at some point on my channel.
I quite like Alexa. Have you seen the video of the parrot that made the shopping list with Alexa? I'll show you after, it's so funny.
Yeah, right. Ah, oh, there's more here. Right.
Oh, nice!
Pac-Man Stories is the first project from Bandai Namco's newly established innovation department, which aims to find and develop new areas and heights in entertainment. Voice-controlled services are an exciting technology, with this great vision of being in everyone's room and used by any family member, said Bandai Namco president Naoki Katashima. When you look at it that way, it does make games seem a more natural fit for the technology than you'd originally think. Although whether audio-only video games becomes any more than a novelty remains to be seen. Interesting. Well, so like I say, it's definitely got our vote, that's for certain.
I love it.
Yeah.
I've never even played it and I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh boy. Right, so that's the news out of the way, eventually. That took us a fair amount of time. We've been at this for... Hold on a second. Oh my word, we've been at this for an hour and a half.
Oh wow.
And, actually, let's get a time update. Goodness me, it's 3 o'clock already.
Wow.
We have been very busy this afternoon.
Yeah.
Right, now... the last section of the show, and it's time to get through those points and trophies in the Trophy Achievement Hunter section.
Points and trophies, Trophy Achievement Hunting, points and trophies, Trophy Achievement Hunting.
Alright, here we go. Super Mega Baseball 2. This is where the appropriate... Right, 42 achievements. Now, obviously, I'm not going to go through all of them because, I mean, normally I would go through them all because it's a game that just came out, but I'm going to go through the high scoring ones. Anything that's above. Wait, hang on. Let's see if I can sort it out. View. There we go. Xbox.com order. Gamer score, that's what we're after. Ascending order, that's what we're after. There we go. I need to apply, that's what I need to do. And boom, there we go. Let's see. Let's see. I mean, a lot of these are obviously rare achievements at the moment because, like I say, the game just came out yesterday. So I'm going to go through some of the... Right. I'm going to go for the... anything above... Anything that's 40 gamer score or above works for me. Right, so let's get started. Cream of the Custom, 40 gamer score for that one. Win the Championship of a Custom Season. And then another one is Your Bagel, Sir. pitch a 9 plus inning complete game shutout in a standard season or standard elimination game. A 9 plus inning.
I don't know what that means.
Hang on. 9 plus. Yeah, shutouts. That's what we're after. That's what it is. So basically, a shutout refers to the act. Yes, we're using a Wikipedia page, folks. I know it's not the most reliable in the world, but it does the job regardless. So, let's see. In Major League Baseball, a shutout refers to the act by which a single pitcher pitches a complete game and does not allow the opposing team to score a run.
Okay.
So essentially, have one pitcher pitch the entire game and... Wow. And I can understand what I say. That's definitely going to be fun to get. Right. Bracket Boss. Win the championship of a standard elimination. 40 game score for that one. Batter Extraordinaire. Tally a regular season batting average of 0.400 with a player on your team. 60 plus plate appearances. Plate appearances. I can see how that would look. Yeah. Plate appearance. Basically, stepping up to the plate maybe three times in an inning, and then just. Anyway. Pitcher Extraordinaire. The batter extraordinaire, that's 50 game score. The pitcher extraordinaire, 50 game score as well. Tally a regular season ERA under 1.5 with a pitcher on your team. 30 plus inning. At least 30 innings pitched. Put a ring on it.
Love it.
They've been listening to Beyonce too much.
Love it.
50 gamer score for that one. Win the championship of a standard season, which would basically be the World Series. Perfecto. Pitch a 9 plus inning complete game, perfect game in season or elimination mode. I would imagine that would be 3 strikeouts in each inning. Anyway, 80 gamer score for that one. SMB2 Master, 80 gamer score. Win the championship of a standard season with a season average ego of 80 or higher. Basically, the higher the ego, the bigger the higher the difficulty. This one's going to be fun. Hashtag Ego 99 Challenge. 100 gamer score. Win a 9 plus inning game against the CPU at Ego 99, where both teams are standard teams. Well, looks like I'm going to have fun with this game. And like I say, folks, that is free right now for the whole of May And it just came out yesterday as a brand new game as well. It's available right now on Xbox, on all platforms, and it's free right now on Xbox as part of the Games with Gold program. So, after over an hour and a half of covering everything, this is definitely going to be in two parts. So anyway, that's it for today, folks. If you enjoyed what you saw, hit the thumbs up. And if you want to be baptized into following this channel, hit the subscribe button down at the bottom. Click the bell to join the Latter-day Saints notification squad. On the top left, part one of this week's podcast and the dedicated podcast list playlist on the right. Saturday is Tom and Jerry Sins Day, and then I might get something up on Monday, but I'm not 100% certain as to whether I'll be able to or not, because I'm going to be in Bristol for the bank holiday weekend. So, in the meantime, we'll see you guys again very soon. Have a fantastic day. Peace out and stay faithful.